Good morning. Welcome to worship, friends, and happy kind of belated Pentecost Sunday. This is actually not really Pentecost Sunday. It's just when our church is celebrating Pentecost. We are very glad to push it a week so we could properly celebrate the Children's Sunday last week. So Pentecost is the birthday of the church. It's the day that we celebrate the Holy Spirit coming and making its home among us, making God's home in our hearts. And indeed, God's home still remains in us. So we are glad to celebrate this every day. And we are glad to have Janine with us. Janine is here from the Perry Housing Partnership. And it is a group that works to give homes to the homeless and hope to people in despair. Truly, it's fitting to have you here on Pentecost. A day that we remember the way that the Spirit fills us all with gifts to use in service to make this world a better place, to make this world like the kingdom of God. So we're going to be talking with Janine later and hear what she does in her work with the homeless and those who have housing insecurity. Some announcements for you all. PWA will not be meeting on June 28th. It will be meeting on June 21st. After church, we hope that you stick around for a birthday celebration. This is a birthday for the church. Stick around, have some birthday cake, and let's do some celebrating. And thank you to everyone who's sporting some red today. It's a great way to celebrate Pentecost. There is a walking group tomorrow at 7, so we hope that if you have some free time, you'll show up and enjoy a time of fellowship and walking and just enjoying this beautiful area that we live in. We have a Father's Day breakfast coming up next Sunday. It's going to be 9:15, so all the dads out there, we hope you come and bring whatever loved ones you have with you. There's going to be pastries and donuts and bagels and fruit and sausage and more. It's just going to be a great time of fellowship and celebrating. Come to worship early, and we'll have a great time of fellowship and celebrating together. There will be no Sunday school because of that. Next week is when the news articles are due. So if you're someone who has some things to turn in for the July, August, or is it? No, it wouldn't be June. Whatever the next newsletter is, make sure you get those articles turned in for it. We do have some unfortunate information to pass on to you. I'm not sure if you heard, but we unfortunately had to cancel our Chris Lynn community camp that was scheduled to be here in the month of July for a week. They unfortunately were having some unforeseen staffing issues that came up all of a sudden, and they had to pull back their staff that was scheduled to be with us at that week. So we are very sad to not get to minister to our kids and the kids of the community that week in that way, but our session and some other leaders in the church are already thinking about what we can do to use our human and financial resources that we are planning to use that week in other ways to serve our community and maybe serve other groups as well. Friends, let us go to our God in worship on this Pentecost Sunday. Wild and free, creative and refreshing, God's Spirit blows through this place. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Gentle and mysterious, patient and caring, God's Spirit moves in our hearts. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Breaking barriers and making connections, healing divisions and making us one, God's Spirit flows between us. Come, Holy Spirit, come. The Spirit of God is here, ready and willing to fill our hearts. So let us invite the Spirit's presence with us and between us by singing hymn 126, Come Holy Spirit, Heavenly Dove. I invite you to stand. On Pentecost Sunday, we celebrate our gift of the Holy Spirit, which empowers us, guides us, corrects us, and encourages us. But even with such a great gift that God has given us, which is present with us every moment of our lives, we still turn away from God's presence and find ourselves in need of God's great mercy. So friends, let us go to our gracious God in repentance together, asking to be forgiven and made new through God's love for us. Merciful God, God of fire and wind, holy and powerful, mighty and mysterious, we are drawn by your Spirit to this place. As we gather and behold your glory, we become aware of our sin. We have ignored your word. We have rejected your gifts. We have failed in your work. Ignoring the truth of Pentecost, we exclude those different from us. We divide our loyalties and divide our hearts. Let our spirit burn away our sins and fill us with courage so that we might live into the promise of this day and receive the fullness of all you have prepared for us in Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, the Holy Spirit is our down payment of eternity. If you ever wonder if God has wanted to throw in the towel on you, remember and look for the Spirit's presence in your life and believe in God's assurance that you will never be a forgotten part of God's family. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. On this day that we will be talking about homes, I say to you, may you find your home in this church family and your home in God's family. Sisters and brothers, please turn and share the love of God with the other members of God's family seated around you today. Thank you, friends. You may be seated. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, you have made your home in our hearts. We ask that as we hear your word read and as we discuss and learn about housing and homelessness, that we would hear you speaking and be moved to action and faithfulness. Amen.
The first reading today is taken from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 21. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who were speaking Galilean? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and other parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, 'What does this mean?' Some, however, made fun of them and said, 'They have had too much wine.' Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd, 'Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk, as you suppose. It is only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. Then sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood, before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.'"
Thank you.
I'd like to invite the kids forward.
Here is an apple, one apple, and we have one true God. The apple has three parts, the peel, the flesh, and the core. God has three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The three parts of the apple are apple. The peel is an apple. It's not an orange. It's not a banana. The flesh is an apple. It's not a plum. It's not a pear. And the core is an apple. It's not a grapefruit. It's not a watermelon. But this apple, the three parts, peel, flesh, and core, are not three apples, just one apple. The one true God has three persons. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But these three parts are not three gods, they're only one God. The three parts of the apple have three different purposes. The peel protects the apple, it keeps it healthy. The flesh is good to eat. We get all kinds of good things from an apple. We get apple pie, an apple cobbler, apple crisp, candy apples, taffy apples, apple cider, apple butter. Oh my, all kinds of desserts. What do you like the best? Apple cider, apple sauce, sure. And the core has seeds. And when you put the seed in the ground, you'll get an apple tree. And when that happens, what happens? We get lots of apples. Like an apple, the one true God has three persons. God the Father is God. God the Son is God. And God the Holy Spirit is God. And they have three purposes also. God the Father is our protector. He made us. He protects us. He made you and me and all the people in the congregation. He made all things. He keeps everything growing, even apples. But sometimes we do things that we shouldn't and aren't very nice. And God said, that has to be punished. That would make us sad. It would hurt a lot for a long, long time. But God loves us so much that he sent God the Son. God the Son took our punishment for us. His name was Jesus. He was a real man. He suffered, and it hurt a lot, and he died. Like an apple seed is planted in the ground, Jesus was buried. But he was really God. So like an apple seed sprouts and grows up from the ground and gives us apples, Jesus rose from the dead and gave us a brand new, wonderful, beautiful, miraculous lives. But there's something else we need to have that wonderful, beautiful new life. We need faith in Jesus. Now, when you plant an apple seed in the ground, you believe that an apple tree will grow, and that's because you have faith in that apple seed. When you believe that Jesus died and rose again to give you a wonderful, beautiful new life, that's faith in Jesus. Our hearts are like a piece of the ground. The ground can't plant the seed all by itself. Somebody has to put that seed in the ground. You can, yeah. But you can't put faith in Jesus in your own heart. God, the Holy Spirit, does that. He puts faith into our hearts and makes it grow and live there as long as we want him to. When an apple is planted in the ground and the rain makes it grow, we get an apple tree. When the Holy Spirit puts faith into your heart, he feeds it with God's word every time that you read the Bible and pray. You begin to grow in your faith. When an apple tree grows strong and healthy, it bears fruit, apples. When faith is grown strong and healthy, it bears fruit too, joy and goodness and faithfulness, love and peace. When you pick an apple from a tree, you know it's an apple. It looks like an apple. It has three parts, the peel, the flesh, and the core. But it's not three apples. It's one apple. And when your faith brings you to believe in God, the true God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, you don't have three gods, just one God. Let's pray. Dear Father, thank you for bringing us protection and making us. Thank you for giving us Jesus to save us. And thank you for giving us the Holy Spirit to put faith in our hearts. Amen.
Thank you, Ruth Ann. Now I've really won apple pie to celebrate Pentecost. So this summer, we're going to be treated to a lot of different people doing the children's sermons. So Ruth Ann was the first one to step up, and I'm excited to get to see all the other people who will be doing that. The second scripture readings sort of are fitting in with our theme of homes and homelessness. So listen to these readings. The second is from Leviticus chapter 25. If any of your kin fall into difficulty and become dependent on you, you shall support them. They shall live with you as though resident aliens. Do not take interest in advance or otherwise make a profit from them, but fear your God. Let them live with you. And now hear this third scripture reading from the book of Isaiah. It's from chapter 58. Is this not the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, to bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall shine forth like the dawn and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindication shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall rise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. These are God's words for us this morning. So our mission partner for the whole month of June is Perry Housing Partnership. This organization provides safe and affordable housing, ensuring that reasonable housing and reasonable housing and alternatives exist for our senior citizens, disabled individuals, working class families, and disadvantaged residents of Perry County in accordance with the Fair Housing and Equal Opportunities Act. As always, you can make a donation to this organization any Sunday throughout the month. But as Janine is here today, it is a particularly good opportunity for you to do that if you feel led. And you can find the envelope you should find an envelope in front of you in the pew rack if you want to give to this mission opportunity. Janine is the executive director there at the Perry Housing Partnership. So we are very glad to have her here. In fact, she originally signed up just to do a minute for mission, and I talked her into doing a whole interview. I'm very excited that she was willing to do this. So thank you for being willing to come and share your wisdom and your life experience and your understanding of God through all this. So Janine, would you come forward? So Janine, would you start just by telling us about you and about Perry Housing Partnership?
Perry Housing Partnership, how close do I have to hold this? Is that good?
If you hear yourself,
then you're good?
Yeah.
Okay. Perry Housing Partnership began in 2007. And it started to fill a need, to fill a void in housing services in Perry County. I had worked for Perry Human Services. I had volunteered for Habitat for Humanity, so I had some experience in housing. It's always been an interest of mine. And so I started the same time Perry Housing Partnership started. So prior to its existence, anyone who needed emergency shelter or housing assistance had to go to the Red Carpet Inn, which is an old strip motel out on 11 and 15. And if you were sent there for emergency housing, it was only for a number of days. There are no cooking facilities, no transportation facilities, no case managers. It was almost like being banished to a room out off the highway. And there really wasn't much that you could do to assist anybody long term. You try to make those connections. So it was really formed to fill a void. And I had the good fortune of working with someone in Cumberland County that had a great deal of experience at providing housing opportunities for people. He was responsible for the Newport Hotel and the Butts Building and Sherman's Valley. So I really had a golden opportunity to be able to take advantage of his experience and wisdom and being able to bring some programs to Perry County. So historically, we had a number of programs. We did a first-time homebuyer program in Marysville, where we converted 6 rental apartments into homeownership apartments. So we helped people. They didn't have to make down payments. The proceeds were subsidized, so they got properties that were in really good shape for the price of a fixer-upper. And so that was a really nice program. I enjoyed it a lot. I loved being a realtor. I just walked in and showed my properties and got to pick carpet colors and cabinets and all that sort of stuff. It was a great experience. But shortly after that experience is when the HUD housing crisis bubble occurred. And so HUD got itself out of the homeownership business really quickly. They had a glut of properties that were foreclosed on that they needed to move inventory in major cities. So the funding stream sort of dried up. So a lot of what I do is sort of directed by what funds are available and what can I do with those funds at the time. I wrote a grant to assist Habitat for Humanity in completing 5 units in Newport. Some of the folks there decided that they were going to build 5 units on faith and the Lord would provide to get those projects completed, and they were kind of dragging on a little bit. But, you know, oddly enough, this grant that I applied for was at the right time and came through unexpectedly, and we were able to complete those 5 homes. And that was really kind of awesome. Have a housing program for disabled veterans in New Bloomfield. There are 5 individual apartments that folks live in. And it's really, it's an interesting building. I don't know, some of you may have seen probably a month or two ago, and I'll mention his name because he was in the newspaper. Pete Ellerman, or not Pete Ellerman, God bless you, Pete. Not him, not Pete. Mike Ellerman lives in the building, and he's struggled through COVID and cancer and very nearly passed away. And the VA assisted in putting in some handicap accessible housing for him, so he can keep his apartment on the 2nd floor, and he's still struggling quite a bit. But the veterans program is really interesting. We've had a number of people that have died in the building. One of them tragically during COVID, and we were all out of the office, and so he was there a while. I'm kind of jumping my questions here, but some of the challenges, that was truly heartbreaking to have that situation occur. But some of these folks, you know, they're really set in their ways. They would have been living in campers or kind of burned out trailer kind of things, situations. And they have a, you know, a place with camaraderie and dignity. And so that program is really, it's a great program. We had a transitional housing program where there's 7 units in New Bloomfield. That program was great. It provided you an opportunity to really kind of spend almost 2 years with someone, a family situation, an individual situation, and help them kind of navigate through. You had lots of time for case management and to be able to, you know, deliver the long-term support that's really required to try to help somebody stabilize from homelessness into you know, a permanent sort of situation. Unfortunately, the government in all its wisdom decided that transitional housing was not the model that they chose to follow, and they eliminated what's called transitional housing and made it rapid rehousing, which is what we have now. And, you know, I have a lot of problems with the model. Those of you who've done any sort of, well, almost any job you do, you know, revolution comes and out with the old, in with the new, everybody follow a new system, it's bigger, it's better, it's greater. Not always, you know, oftentimes the old way is the right way. I see that so much these days. I saw a little cartoon on the internet the other day where a lady was hanging her clothes out and it was eco-friendly and the wind dries it. And it was just kind of, you know, sort of a, I don't know, oftentimes it's just innovation is for innovation's sake. And we don't really have a lot of time to be able to work. You know, it's more of about moving people quickly. So you're kind of forced to bring people in and put them in place and give them the least amount of your attention and time to move on to the next person. So in major cities where you've got, you know, people setting up camps and you're overwhelmed with the homelessness, the model makes a little more sense than it does for us. But that's currently the program that we're doing.
Is there anything you'd like to say about you personally?
Me personally, I was born and raised in Scranton, Scranton, Pennsylvania. I had a brother who committed suicide when he was 20 years old. So my mom died when I was really young. My dad survived quite a lot longer, so he was kind of the rock of my support. And then I went to Penn State. I married. I have 6 kids. And I don't know.
Okay.
I'm not good at the what about you question.
No, it's good.
Does anybody like to talk about themselves? I'm sure some people do, but I don't.
Yeah, no, you've given us a good snapshot of the organization and your life. Can you tell us about... Can you tell us what homelessness or housing insecurity looks like in Perry County by telling us about some actual stories of people you work with? And please feel free to change names or details of people's lives.
Yeah. Homelessness in Perry County, you've all seen it. You all know what it looks like. I don't really have to tell you too much. Anytime you get to traveling on a back road, you find people that are, you know, have garbage cans for exhaust pipes and that sort of thing. A lot of people are living doubled up, tripled up with family members. You know, grandma's raised the kids, and now grandma's raising the grandkids. And, you know, there's just an unending supply of people that are in difficult housing situations. It's not... You know, you're sleeping on the great kind of community. There are no greats. There's parks. People are in camps. You probably, again, with the newspaper, you probably read about the recent arrest of somebody in New Bloomfield Cemetery, a homeless young person. It amazes me how many kids that are compatriots of my own kids. People that when I worked in the school I was familiar with that come across the threshold and need assistance. But that's really the escaping domestic violence. That's a huge one. There are a lot of people in high pressure situations. The pressure's only ratcheted up in this environment, and there are a good deal of people. We work very closely with the YWCA. They're out of Harrisburg, so they're not local. Cumberland Perry Domestic Violence has the contract to provide domestic violence services in this county, but frankly, they're really overwhelmed with the services they provide in Cumberland County, and Perry doesn't always get the same level of attention. We're remote. People are hesitant to leave a violent situation, go over the mountain to a place they don't know. The shelters are always full. Every shelter in all the surrounding area, it's really, really hard to find a shelter space, and staying in that space is even harder. You know, some places have rules, some places with COVID there were rules that, you know, of congregating in small places, and it's a tragic, tragic place to find yourself. And it's a situation that really is in need of a solution.
It seems like domestic violence is one of the main contributing factors. I was also hearing you talk about veterans. Are there other groups that sort of are overrepresented in the homeless population in Perry County?
Just about any demographic that you pick out, you could find a population of those folks. The overwhelming binding thing, I think, is mental illness and generational poverty. You know, the combination of people that are in such need. I mean, I've served, and they're the hardest folks to serve are people with severe mental illness. There's a program in Newport called the Fairweather Lodge, and that's designed to assist people that have severe mental illness. It's great for the people who get in, and it's great for the people that fit that model, but we need 16 more of them, and they have to have a diversity of the population they're interested in serving. The Fairweather Lodge model is great. It kind of, it takes people and it empowers them. So you have, in Newport, you have, I think it's designed for five. It's not always full, but it's designed for five individuals. And they each have a say in making the rules of the household. They have work, they provide transportation and earn a good bit of money. It's a self-sustaining organization. They do receive funds from the County Mental Health Association, but the model itself allows them to build equity in their own lives. But one of the, you know, the promises are the faults in that they do get a say, and if the person that's coming in doesn't impress them as someone that they want to live with, they vote that person out. I mean, it's almost, you know, it just really needs to be duplicated in many situations with people that are interested in serving people who have addiction issues or people who are schizophrenic or, you know, there's such a need. There's just, it's, you know, it's overwhelming. It really is.
Yeah, so talking about being overwhelmed, it leads to my next question. What do you find most rewarding and challenging in your work?
This one I spent a lot of time thinking about and trying to make sure that I didn't spend too much time on the negativity. You know, it is really overwhelming, and I've found my vessel drained a lot lately in just trying to deal with the politics of today, the cultural divisions, the moral divisions, the desperation that so many people feel in such difficult and trying times. You know, getting community consensus on what needs to happen. Some of it I just retreated from, frankly. COVID came around, and I had an excuse to stay in my home. My office burned a couple of years ago, which is still not renovated. And so today, actually, is really kind of, when you asked me to do this, my first thought was, oh no, I don't want to do this. But when I thought about it a little bit, you know, this place just means so much to me, and so do the people in it. And so it seemed like this was, you know, a God-given opportunity to come and talk to people beside my son who works from the basement. just to get out and try to focus a little bit on the people I'm serving and the purpose of the mission, as opposed to all of the crap that rolls around in trying to serve a population. I host a monthly meeting of support professionals. So anybody who provides social services in the county is invited to participate. And we get together on a monthly basis and, you know, just we have a speaker, we talk about what's going on in the agencies, just try to keep connected, because when you need somebody, knowing them is so much easier than calling a number and saying, this is the story. Having a personal connection with somebody at the mental health office is really helpful when you've got a mental health crisis, and it just, it's very broad. But during that meeting, you know, I experienced somebody talking about how the people that really needed help, kind of condemning the idea that the transitional housing program changed its model, which I had absolutely no control over, and that the people who really need help, the homeowners, the people who are taxpayers, they're the people that need the assistance. And it's just, it's heartbreaking, really, to have that sort of feedback, and it happens so frequently. People look at the population that I serve and feel they're undeserving or less than. And sadly, in the past couple of years, part of the reason for my hiding in my world is because with COVID, you could not evict anyone. And there were situations where I had drug dealers in the Veterans Building as well as the Warren House. And so my building is a shambles and looks awful, and the borough is like always beating down my door for the things that are left, the people that are there, and just, I was really afraid of the one drug dealer, and he had a wife and three kids, and those kids, they lived just a horrible existence. Just a horrible, they were abused, they're, it was just, it's the kind of thing that you want to do something about, and it's beyond your control. I literally did not go to the door because I had been verbally assaulted. I had to call the state police. I was really in fear of them, and so they were there for a long time, and some of all of that fallout just sort of drifts about the community, and you become, you know, you get a reputation for helping these people. And instead of asking, what can we do? Is there something that can be done to assist this situation? It's more about just kind of condemning and you know, all the talk that goes on in a small town and small communities. And it was just easier for me to hide in my house for a while. So I'm hoping to be able to stretch out. And the contractors are finally at the paint stage in my property, and it still looks bad from the outside. 2 years later, 2 years later, I just, I'm not a sewer. I don't really, you know, it's not my nature to have a legal fight with a contractor. I just pray. I just want it to be whole so that we can kind of focus on some of the things that need to be addressed and that, you know, are more important in serving the people rather than trying to put out fires and, you know, that sort of thing. Well, literally put out fires.
Yeah. Well. Sadly. I think we only have time for one more question, and I want to explicitly pull in our faith here. So I want to ask you, how has God surprised you in your work, or what have you learned about God in the course of doing your work with Prairie Housing Partnership?
I thought about this question a lot because I haven't really thought about it. My overwhelming conclusion is that I really need to focus a lot more on God and lean on God in helping to move things forward. You know, it's just a situation where, you know, you have to spend the time contemplating God and having conversations with God, and I've just been so wrapped up in minutia, data, and, you know, all sorts of nonsense that has very little to do with the mission. And thinking about all the questions that you sent me, some that we won't get to today, which is really great. But, you know, it's really been an interesting week for me to reflect and to think about just how far I've moved away from God and the reality that God just doesn't leave you. It's there when you decide that you want to return. And it's just, it's looking at the faces of the people that you're trying to help. And just recognizing that it's not necessarily a personal failure or a professional failure when things don't work out, that you have to place that in God's hands and you can't take it personally, that people still die of overdoses and people are still homeless in places, and you can't solve the mental health crisis, and you know, as much time and effort as you want to put into it, these problems are going to exist. And you know, it's obviously, it's sort of a government-funded nonprofit, so it's not really focused on the religious aspect of it. But this week has really kind of taught me that I need to spend more time in contemplation, and even if I can't deliver the word or a word, it can fill me to be able to do the work that I need to do, and to assist the people that we work with. It's been very interesting.
Yeah. Well,
thank you so much for being willing to
come to our church and share with us from your life and your wisdom and your experience. I learned a lot about what homelessness is like in Perry County.
Seeing it through your eyes.
So let's thank Janine together. And is it okay if I close with a word of prayer for you?
Absolutely.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for your daughter, Janine. God, I hear the exhaustion in her. There's a lot of broken people, a lot of brokenness out there, and I am grateful that there are people like Janine out there who haven't given up and thrown their hands up in the air, but are willing to champion the cause of homelessness and poverty, and are willing to help these people who have deep, deep struggles, God, and help them, especially knowing that there are so many out there who don't know how to help. So we pray for strength and endurance for her and all those that she works with. We pray that she would feel your presence with her as she does her work, and feel joy knowing that she is indeed doing your work. So we thank you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you, friends. This was a new experience for us. I've never done an interview like this, so I'm really grateful that Janine was willing to be the first person willing to do it. As you can see, it's getting a little late, so we are going to skip our next hymn, and we're going to move right into our prayer of thanksgiving. So let's lift up a prayer of thanks to the Lord. Gracious and loving God, you have given us homes in heaven and homes here on earth. You've blessed us with food to nourish our bodies and spiritual foods to nourish our souls. You empower us with gifts and abilities to make our world more wonderful and serve those in need around us. God, you are indeed so good to us.
Out of gratitude for who you are and all that you've done, we give to you these tithes and offerings today. We ask that you bless our gifts, that they may be used to bless others and spread your kingdom of love here on earth. Amen. So friends, as we lift up our prayer concerns, I just have some to highlight here together. This week is VBS week, so I encourage you to be in prayer for all of our leaders and kids that will be here. Let us continue to pray for those in Perry County who have no homes or who struggle with housing insecurity. Let's pray for those affected by the shooting in Philly. There was three who were killed and 11 wounded last week. I got to visit with Sarah Simpson last week, and she wanted to thank those in our congregation who had written her a card and to ask that you keep her in your prayers as she continues to miss her husband, Jim. Let's pray for Charlie and Dory's grandson, who was recently diagnosed with diabetes. Let's also pray for David and Katie Riesinger. Katie is going to be having a C-section tomorrow morning. If you would lift up my wife in prayer, she's recovering from food poisoning. She got it last night and is feeling really crummy. Please be praying for Linda Brandt. She's being operated on this morning for a broken hip. This is Kathy Howard's sister-in-law. Pray for Nancy's sister, Connie, as she begins her radiation treatment this week. This is Nancy Neely. Friends, the Lord knows our hearts, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Empowering Spirit, you fill us, move us, inspire us, guide us, and love us. As we bear our hearts to you this morning and remember the things in our lives and in our world that we hold most dear, the things that bring us worry and pain, we ask that you would comfort us, O great Comforter. May we feel your presence with us, reminding us not only that we are never alone as we walk this earth, but may your presence with us remind us of the power that we bear to do great acts of love and justice and compassion and service to those who need it. So, full of your Spirit, we lift up in prayer these concerns from our hearts. We pray for the ministry that's going to be happening here this week at Vacation Bible School. Holy Spirit, be in every interaction between our ministry leaders and the kids they serve. May the kids experience your love for them in everything they see and hear this week. And may your love change their hearts. We pray for all of those experiencing housing insecurity. Holy Spirit, be a comforting presence in their lives, bringing them peace and assurance even when their lives are difficult. We continue to lift up in prayer the communities in our world that are reeling from mass shootings in recent weeks, especially Buffalo, New York, Irvine, Taiwanese Presbyterian Church, Uvalde, Texas, and Philadelphia, PA. We lift up in prayer all the people that we are praying for today. We pray for Sarah as she continues to miss Jim. We pray for the Riesinger's grandson as pray for wisdom for the doctors and parents in light of the diagnosis. Pray for David and Katie, for Katie's health and the health of their child. And we lift up all in our hearts all the other silent prayers that we have. Holy Spirit, fill us, renew us, empower us. We pray all this in Jesus' name, and we pray the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, would you stand and join us in singing our last hymn? It's number 316, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Friends, may you go in peace, empowered by the Spirit to do God's will. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Go in peace.